Last Sunday, I commented on how everybody was sitting on this side of the room, thought it might keel over. Today, I think it's back heavy. You know, the Baptists like to sit as far back as they can in the ship. I don't know what that's about, but it's true. Hello, Jonathan. Good to see you. Welcome to the worship of God at First Baptist Church on this Sunday named Joy. That's what Gaudete means. You can see that word in your order of worship there at the top. We light on Gaudete Sunday, the Sunday of Joy, the rose-colored candle on the Advent wreath. And today, the sermon is offered in song by the sanctuary choir. I'm not doing any announcements today, so please pay close attention to the back of your order of worship, to the newsletter that you should have, and to that one-page Advent calendar that we put out. Instead of announcements, I want to use this time of gathering to speak just briefly to what happened in Kentucky yesterday. Governor Beshear said yesterday that the tornado that leveled Mayfield, Kentucky, not to be confused with my hometown of Maysville, Mayfield, Kentucky, that tornado scraped its way across 227 miles of earth. It was a Category 4. 200 of those miles were in our Commonwealth. We are presently today under a state of emergency. The governor called it, quote, the most devastating tornado event in our state history. And if you've seen the photos of Mayfield, it's really hard to disagree with that. Today, we sing. Today is called Gaudete, joy. But not without the qualification of that sorrow. Kind of like Advent and Christmas themselves. You see, Mary sings her Magnificat, but it is not without birth pangs. Zechariah prophesies redemption, but also mentions the shadow of death. Simeon dedicates the infant Jesus, a light for revelation, he says, whose life will bring a piercing sword to his mama's heart. And Anna, the 84-year-old widow who is a prophet in the temple, sings praise to God anyway. That's all written into our sacred story of Advent and Christmas and carries us today as we mingle our grief and our joy. So, let's observe a moment of silence this morning for our fellow human beings, and then we'll pray together. God of Advent, God of Christmas, God of hope, peace, joy, and love. God, we enter into this space on this Sunday called Joy with a little bit of sorrow in our hearts. We know this is the Christmas story. This is exactly how it felt to our ancestors. We come today with those two things weighing on us. God, for the people of Mayfield, for the people all around them, all the people affected by that awful storm, we pray this morning for their Christmas that will look completely different than they expected. We pray this morning for their families, their friends, their homes, their lives, their jobs, all of those things. We pray this morning. And God, like that old prophet in the temple named Anna, we sing anyway We sing for joy because you are you. So be with us as we sing, as we anticipate, as we carry Advent and Christmas forward, for not just ourselves, but for our fellow humankind too. In Christ's name we pray it. Amen. If you would, take your order of worship with the Advent wreaths on the top of it, and join me in the call to worship that is printed there. Give thanks to the Lord and call upon the holy name of the Most High God.
The Lord is our strength and our salvation.
Proclaim the mercy of the one who comes as one of us.
The Lord is our strength and our salvation.
Trust and do not be afraid.
The Lord is our strength and our salvation.
With joy, you will draw water from the wells of peace.
The Lord is our strength and our salvation. Hallelujah. Amen.
Feels a little different today, right? Welcome to worship.
Will you stand and let's sing together Carol 103.
The old egg-headed guys that came up with the church calendar, whenever that was, however long ago that was, called Advent many things, including a season of penitence or repentance. It is our practice at First Baptist Church to have a time of confession and assurance of forgiveness in our worship service to set our hearts right for the time of worship that we are entering into. You will again need your order of worship as we join together, you, I, and Beth, in this call, prayer, and assurance printed there. As John the Baptist called the people to repent, as Jesus calls us now, we turn to the one who is both judge and savior, trusting that repentance opens the door to new life, and that peace beyond all measure has been promised to us.
Let us confess our sins. The Lord is near.
In your presence,
we have broken your commands against idolatry. We have not trusted your word, and we are afraid.
In the name of the one God who lives and moves among us, you and we are forgiven.
The Lord has taken away the judgments against us.
Do not worry.
Live in
peace. Amen. Things look different in the church this time of year. We use purple cloth and candles, and we have evergreens and garland. This time of year, we turn the page as the church. It's a new year in the church calendar. We turn the page from the risen Christ triumphant over all creation on Reign of Christ Sunday to a darkness reflected in these November and December days, and a hope for a better world. Advent is a time of anticipation. To anticipate means to see as a probable occurrence, to expect. There is a connotation of pleasure in looking forward, in that posture of looking forward, of anticipation. During Advent, we are looking forward to the birth of Jesus. We look forward to it through the deep darkness that Matthew, Luke, and John all make sure to include in the beginning of their stories of Jesus' advent on this earth.
We light the third candle of Advent. We seek God's comfort. Both mighty and tender, God comes to us. Prepare our hearts to be filled with joy.
Saving God, look upon your world and heal your hand and your people. Prepare us, make us ready to be changed. This Advent, teach us to be gentle and gracious and joyful as you are.
Shine on us, God of joy.
And your response is?
Come to us, Christ of light.
Let's pray. God, thank you for inviting us into your space, the space among people, the space where we can lean on one another, enjoy one another's company, pray, listen, worship, sing together. Be present with us in our joy today as the sermon comes in song from the choir who's worked on it for a long time now. Be with us as we anticipate the coming of Jesus in that manger in Bethlehem, oh so soon now. Be with us this very hour and all the days of our life. God, as we sit here, as we hear the sermon in song, and as we go from this place on this Sunday called Joy, teach us again to pray. Teach us to pray that prayer that Jesus teaches his disciples to pray, which we claim to be, that when we get out in the world and get busy, we might still have these words in our hearts, that we could say them anytime, anywhere, we find ourselves. We join our voices in learning again that prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen.
Our first lesson today is from the Old Testament book of Isaiah. God is indeed my salvation. I will trust and won't be afraid. Yahweh, the Lord is my strength and my shield. He has become my salvation. You will draw water with joy from the springs of salvation. And you will say on that day, thank the Lord, call on God's name, proclaim God's deeds among the peoples, declare that God's name is exalted. Sing to the Lord, who has done glorious things. Proclaim this throughout all the earth. Shout and sing for joy, city of Zion, because the Holy One of Israel is great among us.
Today's gospel lesson comes from the gospel according to Luke. It is from the first chapter. And in a lot of ways, the cantata will be a sermon on this story. Mary got up and hurried to a city in the Judean highlands. She entered Zechariah's home and greeted Elizabeth. When Elizabeth heard Mary's greeting, the child leaped in her womb. And Elizabeth was filled with the Holy Spirit. With a loud voice, she blurted out, God has blessed you above all women, and he has blessed the child you carry. Why do I have this honor that the mother of my Lord should come to me? As soon as I heard your greeting, the baby in my womb jumped for joy. Happy is she who believed that the Lord would fulfill the promises he made to her. Mary said, with all my heart, I glorify the Lord. In the depths of who I am, I rejoice in God my Savior. He has looked with favor on the low status of his servants. Look, from now on, everyone will consider me highly favored, because the Mighty One has done great things for me. Holy is his name.
No. The church is Advent. The unwrapping of God's greatest gift is near. Advent coming. God will take away the tinsel and decorate our human hearts in hope, so that Christians can sit laughing in the rain, knowing that the Lord is going to shine in upon their being. For no matter how long the darkness, God will send the light. In spite of cursing and violence and the massacring of human dignity, we will dance in the streets of Bethlehem, for he will be born. We are freed to free others. We are affirmed to affirm others. We are loved to love others. We are family. We are community. We are the church triumphant. You, me, anyone who would come unto the Lord, renewed, redirected, and empowered to change things and lives together in love and wholeness. We are the Lord's church, the church of justice and mercy.
Thank you.
each heart lies a Bethlehem, an inn where we must ultimately answer whether there is room or not. When we are Bethlehem bound, we experience our own advent in His. When we are Bethlehem bound, we can no longer look the other way, conveniently not seeing stars, not hearing angel voices. We can no longer excuse ourselves by busily tending our sheep or our kingdoms. This Advent, let's go to Bethlehem and see this thing that the Lord has made known to us. In the midst of shopping sprees, let's ponder in our hearts the gift of gifts. Through the tinsel, let's look for the gold of the Christmas star. In the excitement and confusion, in the merry chaos, let's listen for the brush of angel wings. This Advent, let's go to Bethlehem and find our kneeling places. Christmas spirit is that hope which tenaciously clings to the hearts of the faithful and announces, in the face of any Herod the world can produce, and all the indoors slammed in our faces, and all the dark nights of our souls, that with God, all things still are possible. That even now, unto us a child is born.
Mm-hmm.
Into the wild and painful cold of the starless winter night came the refugees, slowly making their way to the border. The man, stooped from age or anxiety, hurried his small family through the wind. Bearded and dark, his skin rough and cracked from the cold, his frame looming large in spite of the slumped shoulders. He looked like a man who could take care of whatever came at them from the dark. Unless, of course, there were too many of them. One man he could handle, two even, but a border patrol, they wouldn't have a chance. His eyes, black and alert, darted from side to side, then over his shoulder, then back forward again. Had they been seen? Had they been heard? Every rustle of wind, every sigh from the child sent terror through his chest. Was this the way? Even the stars had been unkind, had hidden themselves in the ink of night so that the man could not read their way. Only the wind. Was it enough? Only the wind and his innate sense of direction. What kind of cruel judgment would that be, to wander in circles through the night? Or to safely make their way to the border, only to find the authorities waiting for them? He glanced at the young woman, his bride, no more than a child herself. She nuzzled their newborn, kissing his neck. She looked up, caught his eye, and smiled. Oh, how the homelessness had taken its toll on her. Her eyes were red, her young face lined, her lovely hair matted from inattention, her clothes stained from milk and baby, her hands chapped from the raw of winter. She'd hardly had time to recover from childbirth when word had come that they were hunted, and they fled with only a little bread, the remaining wine, and a very small portion of cheese. Suddenly, the child began to make small noises. The man drew his breath in sharply. The woman quietly put the child to rest. Fear. Long, dread-filled moments. Huddled, the family stood still in the long silence. At last, the man breathed deeply again, reassured they had not been heard. And into the night continued Mary and Joseph and the babe. Later, after the angels, after the stable, after the child, they went back, as we always must. Back to the world that doesn't understand our talk of angels and stars, and especially not the child. We go back complaining that it doesn't last. They went back singing praises to God. We do have to go back, but we can still sing the Alleluias.
The song of the angels is still.
What do I want for Christmas? I want to kneel in Bethlehem, the air thick with alleluias, the angels singing that God is born among us. In the light of the star, I want to see them come, the wise ones and the humble. I want to see them come bearing whatever they treasure to lay at the feet of him who gives his life. What do I want for Christmas? To see that stable, the whole world kneeling in thanks for a promise kept, new life. For in his nativity, we find ours.
Thank you. Into the stable they straggled, poor and dirty, hardly suitably dressed for polite society. Had we been Joseph, we would have feared robbery. Had we been Mary, we would have feared germs around our newborn. Had we been God, these are not the ones we would have chosen to first come and see the child. After all, they showed a certain carelessness about the rules of the church. And yet, God chosen, they came to kneel and worship him, whom we would later call the Good Shepherd. Perhaps we could brush up on our humbleness.
Christmas is so very close now. We have stood on our tiptoes, peeked just over, and caught glimpses of it on this Sunday called joy. That's exactly what the third Sunday of Advent is for. Would you stand? Would you stand and receive this benediction, this good word, as we continue our journey through Advent? May the strength of Christ uplift you, the comfort of the Holy Spirit surround you, and the grace and mercy of God give you hope and give you courage this day and every day. Amen.